LGM-30G Minuteman III program started in 1966 and included several improvements over the previous versions. It was first deployed in 1970. Most modifications related to the final stage and reentry system, RS. The final third stage was improved with a new fluid-injected motor, giving finer control than the previous four-nozzle system. Performance improvements realized in Minuteman III include increased flexibility in re-entry vehicle, RV, and penetration aids deployment, increased survivability after a nuclear attack, and increased payload capacity. The missile retains a gimbaled inertial navigation system. Minuteman III originally contained several distinguishing features. Armed with up to 3 W62 Mk-12 warheads, having a yield of only 170 kilotons TNT, instead of the previous W56's yield of 1.2 megatons. It was the first multiple independently targetable re-entry vehicle's MIRV missile. A single missile was then able to target three separate locations. This was an improvement from the Minuteman I and Minuteman II models, which were able to carry only one large warhead. An RS capable of deploying, in addition to the warheads, penetration aids such as chaff and decoys. Minuteman III introduced in the post-boost stage bus an additional liquid fuel propulsion system rocket engine, PSRE, that is used to slightly adjust the trajectory. This enables it to dispense decoys, or with MIRV, dispense individual RVs to separate targets. The PSRE uses the bipropellant Rocketdyne RS-14 engine. The Hercules M57 third stage of Minuteman I and Minuteman II had thrust termination ports on the sides. These ports, when opened by the detonation of shaped charges, reduced the chamber pressure so abruptly that the interior flame was blown out. This allowed a precisely timed termination of thrust for targeting accuracy. The larger Minuteman III third stage motor also has thrust termination ports, although the final velocity is determined by PSRE. A fixed nozzle with a liquid injection thrust vector control, TVC, system on the new third stage motor, similar to the second stage Minuteman II nozzle, additionally increased range. A flight computer, Autonetics D37D, with larger disk memory and enhanced capability. A Honeywell HDC-701 flight computer that employed non-destructive readout, NDRO, plated wire memory instead of rotating magnetic disk for primary storage was developed as a backup for the D37D, but was never adopted. The Guidance Replacement Program, GRP, initiated in 1993, replaced the disk-based D37D flight computer with a new one that uses radiation-resistant semiconductor RAM. The Minuteman III missiles used D37D computers and completed the 1,000 missile deployment of this system. The initial cost of these computers ranged from about $139,000, D37C, to $250,000, D17B. Minuteman III MIRV launch sequence comprises of, the missile launches out of its silo, by firing its first stage boost motor about 60 seconds after launch, the first stage drops off and the second stage motor ignites. The missile shroud is ejected. About 120 seconds after launch, the third stage motor ignites and separates from the second stage. About 180 seconds after launch, third stage thrust terminates and the post-boost vehicle separates from the rocket. The post-boost vehicle maneuvers itself and prepares for re-entry vehicle deployment. The RVs, as well as decoys and chaff, are deployed during back away. The RVs and chaff re-enter the atmosphere at high speeds and are armed in flight. The nuclear warheads initiate, either as air bursts or ground bursts. The existing Minuteman III missiles have been further improved over the decades in service, with more than $7 billion spent in the last decade to upgrade the 450 missiles. The Minuteman III has a length of 18.3 meters, weighs 36,030 kilograms, an operational range of greater than 9,700 kilometers, and an accuracy of about 240 meters. In December 1979, the higher yield W78 warhead of 335 to 350 kilotons began replacing a number of the W62s deployed on the Minuteman III. These were delivered in the Mark 12 air reentry vehicle. a small, unknown number of the previous Mark 12 RVs were retained operationally, however, to maintain a capability to attack more distant targets in the South Central Asian republics of the USSR, the Mark 12 RV weighed slightly less than the Mark 12A. The Guidance Replacement Program, GRP, replaces the NS-20A missile guidance set with the NS-50 missile guidance set. The newer system extends the service life of the Minuteman missile beyond the year 2030 by replacing aging parts and assemblies with current, high-reliability technology, while maintaining the current accuracy performance. The replacement program was completed on 25 February 2008. Beginning in 1998 and continuing through 2009, the propulsion replacement program extends the life and maintains the performance by replacing the old solid propellant boosters. The Single Reentry Vehicle, SRV, modification enabled the United States ICBM force to abide by the now vacated START II treaty requirements by reconfiguring Minuteman III missiles from three reentry vehicles down to one. Though it was eventually ratified by both parties, START II never entered into force, and was essentially superseded by follow-on agreements such as SARD and New START, which do not limit MIRV capability. Minuteman III remains fitted with a single warhead due to the warhead limitations in New START. Beginning in 2005, MK-21W87 RVs from the deactivated Peacekeeper missile will be placed on the Minuteman III force under the Safety Enhanced Reentry Vehicle, SERV, program. The older W78 does not have many of the safety features of the newer W87, such as insensitive high explosive, as well as more advanced safety devices. In addition to implementing these safety features in at least a portion of the future Minuteman III force, the decision to transfer W87s onto the missile is based on two features that will improve the targeting capabilities of the weapon, more fusing options which will allow for greater targeting flexibility, and the most accurate re-entry vehicle available which provides a greater probability of damage to the designated targets. The Minuteman III missile entered service in 1970, with weapon systems upgrades included during the production run from 1970 to 1978 to increase accuracy and payload capacity. As of September 2019, the USAF plans to operate it until 2030. The LGM-118A Peacekeeper, MX, ICBM, which was to have replaced the Minuteman, was retired in 2005 as part of START II. All Minuteman I and Minuteman II missiles have been retired. The United States prefers to keep its MIRV deterrence on submarine-launched Trident nuclear missiles in 2014. The Air Force decided to put 50 Minuteman III silos into warm unarmed status, taking up half of the 100 slots in America's allowable nuclear reserve. These can be reloaded in the future if necessary. Minuteman III missiles are regularly tested with launches from Vandenberg Air Force Base to validate the effectiveness, readiness, and accuracy of the weapon system, as well as to support the system's primary purpose, nuclear deterrence. The safety features installed on the Minuteman III for each test launch allow the flight controllers to terminate the flight at any time if the systems indicate that its course may take it unsafely over inhabited areas. Since these flights are for test purposes only, even terminated flights can send back valuable information to correct a potential problem with the system. The 576th Flight Test Squadron is responsible for planning, preparing, conducting, and assessing all ICBM ground and flight tests. The Airborne Launch Control System, ALCS, is an integral part of the Minuteman ICBM command and control system, and provides a survivable launch capability for the Minuteman ICBM force, if ground-based launch control centers, LCCs, are destroyed. When the Minuteman ICBM was first placed on alert, the Soviet Union did not have the number of weapons, accuracy, nor significant nuclear yield to destroy the Minuteman ICBM force during an attack. However, starting in the mid-1960s, the Soviets began to gain parity with the US and now had the potential capability to target and successfully attack the Minuteman force with an increased number of ICBMs that had greater yields and accuracy than were previously available. Studying the problem even more, SAC realized that to prevent the US from launching all 1,000 Minuteman ICBMs, the Soviets did not have to target all 1,000 Minuteman missile silos. the Soviets needed to launch only a disarming decapitation strike against the 100 Minuteman LCCs, the command and control sites, to prevent the launch of all Minuteman ICBMs. Even though the Minuteman ICBMs would have been left unscathed in their missile silos following an LCC decapitation strike, the Minuteman missiles could not be launched without a command and control capability. In other words, the Soviets needed only 100 warheads to fully eliminate command and control of the Minuteman ICBMs. Even if the Soviets chose to expend 2 to 3 warheads per LCC for assured damage expectancy, the Soviets would have had to expend only up to 300 warheads to disable the Minuteman ICBM force, far less than the total number of Minuteman silos. The Soviets could have then used the remaining warheads to strike other targets they chose. Faced with only a few Minuteman LCC targets, the Soviets could have concluded that the odds of being successful in a Minuteman LCC decapitation strike were higher with less risk than it would have been having to face the almost insurmountable task of successfully attacking and destroying 1,000 Minuteman silos and 100 Minuteman LCCs to ensure Minuteman was disabled. This theory motivated SAC to design a survivable means to launch Minuteman, even if all the ground-based command and control sites were destroyed. After thorough testing and modification of EC-135 command post aircraft, the AUKS demonstrated its capability on 17 April 1967 by launching an AUKS-configured Minuteman II out of Vandenberg AFB, California. Afterwards, AUKS achieved initial operational capability, IOC, on 31 May 1967. From that point on, airborne missileers stood alert with AUKS-capable EC-135 aircraft for several decades. All Minuteman ICBM launch facilities were modified and built to have the capability to receive commands from AUKS. With AUKS now standing alert around the clock, the Soviets could no longer successfully launch a Minuteman LCC decapitation strike. Even if the Soviets attempted to do so, EC-135s equipped with the AUKS could fly overhead and launch the remaining Minuteman ICBMs in retaliation. Now that AUKS was on alert, this complicated Soviet war planning by forcing the Soviets to target not only the 100 LCCs, but also the 1,000 silos with more than one warhead in order to guarantee destruction. This would have required upwards of 3,000 warheads to complete such an attack. The odds of being successful in such an attack on the Minuteman ICBM force would have been extremely low. The weapon system is now located on board the United States Navy's E-6B Mercury. Although the Minuteman ICBM force has been reduced since the end of the Cold War, the AUKS continues to act as a force multiplier by ensuring that an adversary cannot launch a successful Minuteman LCC decapitation strike. Mobile Minuteman was a program for rail-based ICBMs to help increase survivability, and for which the USAF released details on 12 October 1959. Air-launched ICBM was a StratX proposal in which SAMSO, Space and Missile Systems Organization, successfully conducted an air-mobile feasibility test that airdropped a Minuteman 1B from a C-5A Galaxy aircraft from 6,100 meters over the Pacific Ocean. The missile fired at 2,400 meters, and the 10-second engine burn carried the missile to 6,100 meters again before it dropped into the ocean. The U.S. Air Force has considered using some decommissioned Minuteman missiles in a satellite launching role. These missiles would be stored in silos for launch upon short notice. The payload would be variable and would have the ability to be replaced quickly. This would allow a surge capability in times of emergency. During the 1980s, surplus Minuteman missiles were used to power the Conestoga rocket produced by Space Services Incorporated of America. It was the first privately funded rocket, but saw only 3 flights and was discontinued due to a lack of business. More recently, converted Minuteman missiles have been used to power the Minotaur line of rockets produced by Orbital Sciences, now known as Northrop Grumman Innovation Systems. The Minuteman Missile National Historic Site in South Dakota preserves a launch control facility, D-01, and a launch facility, D-09, under the control of the National Park Service. The North Dakota State Historical Society maintains the Ronald Reagan Minuteman Missile Site, preserving a missile alert facility, launch control center and launch facility in the WS-133B Deuce configuration, near Cooperstown, North Dakota.